Good morning. Now let's try that again. Good morning. Happy to have you here at Liberty Baptist Church, and I hope that you are thrilled to be here in the house of the Lord as we worship and praise our Lord and our Savior, and as we listen to His Word preached here today. A couple of announcements before we get into our song service. Want to let everybody know that we had 113 in our Sunday school Bible study small group time this morning. And if you were here, I hope that you got a real blessing from that. In the class that I'm in, we're currently studying the writings of Paul, and we were studying about his words to the Galatians, and I know that each of our different classes are studying different topics, and I hope that if you were a part of that, you enjoyed that blessing this morning. A couple of upcoming announcements, of course, tonight. Our junior choir will be rehearsing at 6 during our evening worship service time. The adult choir will be practicing afterwards in the back after our evening worship service. Of course, this Wednesday we'll be having our youth Bible study and our children's missions. We will be having prayer time and Bible study here in the sanctuary at 7 o'clock this Wednesday. And then we look forward to next Sunday night at 6 p.m. Next Sunday night, we're going to have an update from those who went to Journey Camp. And we look forward to hearing about the lives that were changed and the impact on those who went for that time a couple of weeks ago. Last announcement that I have is to let everyone know that Walnut Hill Baptist Church is going to be having a youth and student revival that's going to be July the 19th through the 21st. They're located in Harriman. I believe it's starts at 5 p.m., I believe. And so if you need more information, you can contact our church office and they can give you more information about this youth and student revival at Walnut Hill Baptist Church. With that, let's have a time of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we could be here this morning in your house. And dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this opportunity. We pray even now for the great and wondrous things that you have in store for us, dear Lord. And we just pray that our hearts would be open. We just pray that we would be receptive to what you have for us to hear and to sing and to do, dear Heavenly Father, during this time. We pray that you would be with our pastor and his wife as they're away, that you would give them rest and that you would give them safety as they travel. Dear God, we just love you. We praise you, for it's in Christ's name we pray, and amen. I encourage everyone to please stand as we sing hymn number 360, Tell the Good News.
Christ was born in a distant land. Tell the good news, tell the good news. Lived on earth for the good of man. Tell the good news, tell the good news. Tell the good news, tell the good news. Tell the good news that Christ has come. Good news.
number 228, Alas, in my Savior. Fellowship. Thank you. We encourage you to sing with us as we sing the third verse of When We All Get to Heaven.
Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will atone for life we made. When we all get to heaven, on a day.
Number 626, I love to tell the story.
I love to tell the story of amazing things above, of Jesus and His glory. Hungry and
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing on our meeting here this morning. Be with those traveling on vacation. Bring them back to us safe. Lord, we ask your blessing on these tithes and offerings. We ask you to bless this service as it goes on. Lord, let it go as you would have it go. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Kathy. While we hate for our pastor and his wife to be away, we are certainly happy this morning to have Dr. Michael Prince with us, and we look forward to see what God has placed on his heart this morning, if you would come at this time.
Good morning, everyone. I wish you'd all get in this center section so I don't have to turn one way or the other here. It's always so good to be with you. I'm grateful to Pastor Paul for inviting me to preach in this place. You are gracious people. You live in a beautiful part of Tennessee, and God has blessed you with a beautiful house in which to worship. Thank you for letting me be with you. I want to ask you to do me a favor, seriously, every one of you, and I know that Paul's been pastor here for 14 years, and when you see him, the first time you see him, when he comes back, tell him that I preached a powerful message from God's Word on the subject, why a church should change pastors every 5 years. Now, you can't have a smile on your face when you do this, okay? You've got to be serious. And a number of you've got to do it. You've got to rush up to him and say, did you know he was going to preach on that subject? And he's going to say, what subject? You're going to say that we need to change pastors every 5 years just for, you know, for spontaneity, for creativity. Now, Larry, if you're recording this, you cannot let Paul listen to this tape. Okay? Turn with me, if you would, please, in God's Word to the book of Ephesians. Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, the second chapter, the book of Ephesians. I begin reading in verse number 1. Now I'm reading from the New International Version. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live, when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following the desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Therefore remember that formerly you were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. Let our Lord add his blessing to the reading of his holy word. Amen. Well, we have just had a remarkable 3 weeks. When I say we, I mean the whole world, so it seems. Because on June the 23rd, 12 boys after football practice and their young coach decided to ride their bicycles through the rice paddies up into the hills just north of the little village in which they lived and go into a cave. They'd been in this cave many times before. It's a popular place for tourists to go. And they began to explore the cave, and all they had were torches because they expected to be out of the cave in just a little over an hour. But it had been raining for several days, and they had forgotten that often when it rained, the cave flooded. And while they were in the cave, it began to flood, and the flood became greater. A torrent of water began to rush in, and they had to go deeper and deeper into the cave until they were about 2.5 miles inside the cave, and they found refuge on a little shelf above a body of water, and there they were trapped. Of course, they didn't come home that night. Their parents were greatly alarmed. People began to search for them. They knew that they often went to this cave, so they found their bicycles and their packs on the outside of the cave, and they began to search for the boys. In fact, people from all over that area came to search for the boys. In fact, people from all over the world came to search for those boys. Divers, specialists in cave exploration came, and 2 men from England, after about a week of searching, found the boys on this shelf deep within the cave. And of course, you know the rest of the story, how all the world came together in concern. It was as if a great unity covered the earth. Wasn't it amazing? Love was poured out on those boys that none of us had ever met. We prayed for them. We prayed for those who were striving to rescue them. Compassion filled our hearts. There was a focus of concern. It was far more than interest in the story. It was far more than just being interested in the story. There was a unity of compassion and concern and love that covered, so it seemed, the surface of the earth. It was really unusual for that to be the case, because you know as well as I do that we live in a world that is not united with compassion and concern and love. We live in a world that is torn apart. There is the exact opposite of compassion everywhere. There is the exact opposite of unity everywhere. There is the exact opposite of love everywhere, even in our own country, in our own culture, even in our own lives. You cannot turn on the television without hearing an expression, a news item of prejudice, even of hatred. You cannot turn on the news without hearing how somebody is attacking somebody else. And it is increasingly obvious to us that it permeates our world, maybe even our own lives. It is my intent this morning to not preach about how you need to change pastors every 5 years, but to talk rather about how there is a marvelous truth in God's holy word that unites his people together. Like the world was united for two brief weeks, so there is in God's word a marvelous truth that is intended, that has the power to unite God's people together for all of their lives in a common purpose, in a singular focus. And that purpose and that focus is to live for Jesus Christ and to lift him up and him alone and to be his people and to live for him in such a way that there is an obvious difference about us, a difference that the world can see. We're just not like the world because we know Christ Jesus who is Lord. There is an obvious, marvelous, incredible truth in the word of God that molds our hearts, that informs our minds, that strengthens and empowers our feet, a marvelous truth that gives us changed lives. And that truth is that God has sent his son to die for us. And we have met in the one who died for us God's incomparable love. And we have been empowered by the one who died for us with a grace and with a compassion that sends us forth into the world to live lives that allow others to see Jesus in us. I think the Apostle Paul is talking about this marvelous truth in the passage from which I read. It is a passage that strikes at the very heart of our faith. It is a passage that describes for us how our lives, our very lifestyles, must be different, ought to be different, should be different, can be different, because we know Jesus Christ as our Lord. From my earliest days as a Christian, I've heard an expression that seems so simple, and yet it expresses this profound truth about which I'm speaking. You've heard it too. It is the expression, the ground around the cross is level. Haven't you heard that? The ground around the cross is level. And of course, the expression is getting at the fact that the ground around the cross is level because we all come to the Lord the same way. Now, it's not that way in the world. That's what makes us different. If we truly understand that we all come to the Lord on level ground, that makes us marvelously different from the rest of the world, because the world is not built that way. The world has mountains, and people climb up on top of these mountains, and they become powerful people, and they become people that threaten other people, and they hold advantage over others, and there are people who are not on the mountains, and they're considered lesser people, weaker people, often poorer people. And there are different levels in human society, and we compete against one another, and we're often against one another. We do things to hurt one another. Not so in the kingdom of God. And we who live in that kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord understand that it's not that way for us. And yet sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we think that it isn't level in the kingdom of God, that there are some who have achieved more than we, who have earned more acclaim, more fame than we. Take, for instance, the one who first was used of the Lord to write these words, the Apostle Paul. Can you believe that the Apostle Paul and you are on the same level before Jesus Christ? That's kind of hard to fathom, isn't it? All the apostles, John and James and Philip, how can we be on the same level as these great men who served our Lord first? Or what about great Christians of history like Martin Luther. How can it possibly be that you and I are on level ground before Christ with Martin Luther? Not too long before Billy Graham died last February, my wife and I went to his library in Charlotte. It was the first time we'd ever been there, and it brought back all of these childhood memories for me of how, when I was a kid, the most famous Christian in the world, for me, was Billy Graham. And I was just amazed at how the Lord was using him to preach around the world. And this man devoted his life to preaching the good news of Jesus Christ. And God used him to preach in country after country, continent after continent, before millions and millions of people. How can it be that I am on the same level as this great preacher of God's word, Billy Graham? But here's the truth that the Apostle Paul is talking about in his word. It is the truth that only one is lifted up, and that one is Jesus Christ. And Christ said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men to myself. And that's what has happened for us. We have seen him lifted up, and he has drawn us to himself. And now we stand before him. But you know what, dear friends? We are on level ground before the cross when we kneel there to get saved. There was a time in your life, if you know Christ as Lord and Savior, when you came to him and knelt on your face and said, I repent of my sin and I invite you into my life as my Savior and my Lord. Save me. I want to be your child. And when you did that, if you did so in faith, believing in the Word of God tells us that Christ forgave you of your sin and came into your life as your Savior and your Lord. And when you did that, there on your knees before Christ, inviting him into your life as your Savior, you were on the same level as everyone who across the ages has come to Jesus Christ and invited him into their life. The Apostle Paul talks about this in the passage that I have read. Look at verse number 1. He talks about our position. He says, and as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and your sin. He talks about your performance, our performance. Verse number 2 and verse number 3, when he says, we followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. Also, all of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of the flesh. Over in verse 12, he talks about the possibilities that we had at this time when he says in verse 12 that you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. Paul is saying when you come to Christ and invite him into your life, you are absolutely helpless. You have nothing that you can give to him. You are completely, absolutely, totally helpless. You cannot do anything about your sin yourself. And he says, you are absolutely godless. There is nothing in you that's good enough for God to bless. You are godless. You're following the cravings of your mind, the ways of the flesh. You are in sin. You're out of control. And he says, when you come to Christ, you're absolutely hopeless, without hope and without God in the world. And that is level ground. You have nothing that you can bring to him. Nobody ever has. You have nothing to offer him, nothing good in yourself that will make you worthy of his grace and mercy. And you have absolutely no hope, none whatsoever with regard to eternity when you come to Jesus Christ. And that is the level ground, the level ground, the level ground of coming to Jesus Christ and kneeling there before his cross. Ray Summers, who was a great theologian in Baptist life long ago, said that this is the plan of salvation, and only a God of infinite wisdom could conceive of it And only a God of infinite love could accomplish it. I think Dr. Summers hit it right on the nail. Only God could do what he has done in his son Jesus Christ. And all of us, when we come to him and ask him to forgive us of our sin, we come to him on level ground exactly the same way. I love to read biographies. A number of years ago, I read the biography of Dwight L. Moody, a great evangelist of the 19th century. And Dwight L. Moody, late in his life, said that the greatest thing he had ever learned was this: that when he came to God, he had nothing at all that he could give to God. And that when he came to God, God required of him many things, great things. And that when he came to God with nothing, and yet God requiring many things, that God gave him everything he needed in that moment. Dwight L. Moody said, that is the greatest news the world has ever heard. That when you come to Christ, you have nothing to give him, but he gives you everything you need. And that's level ground. So why is it that we sometimes forget that in the community of faith, in the kingdom of God, in the life of the church, we're all the same. We're all on the same level before Christ, who is lifted up before us. Now, imagine something with me for just a minute. Let's say this fine gentleman here in the, what is that, a pink shirt, loan me $500,000. And I used his $500,000 foolishly, unwisely. I wasted it. And he's coming to me and he's asking me to pay him back. After all, it was $500,000. And since I've wasted it and earned nothing with it, I don't have it anymore. In fact, I have nothing. I cannot possibly pay him back. But this gentleman over here in the blue shirt, right here on the front row, he comes to me out of the blue. He doesn't even know me. And he says, I heard you're in trouble, and I have a lot, and I want to give you $500,000 to pay him back. And so he does so. He gives it to me. Without any obligation whatsoever, he just bestows it upon me. And I take this pile of money and I give it back to my former friend, and I am now out of debt. And then I go all over Wartburg and I say, you know, you can trust me, I always pay my debts. I'm a really good guy. I've done a lot in my life, and one thing I've done is I've always met my obligations. And of course, it would be a lie. I haven't met my obligations. What I needed to get out of my predicament was given to me freely, without cost, with no ties whatsoever. Out of grace, it was given to me. And so it is when we come to Christ Jesus and invite him into our life, that which we bring, he gives us freely, out of his grace, in his mercy, in his compassion. And he lifts us up out of the mire of our sin, and he gives us lives to live, lives that can be worthy and full of hope, full of meaning, full of joy. And it's a gift. And so it is. And I think the Apostle Paul teaches this, that not only do we kneel on level ground when we come to Christ, we also serve him on level ground. When we get up off our knees and we start to serve Jesus Christ, we're serving on level ground. Now, in the world, there are altars of prominence. There are humps that people climb up on, and they exert power over others, and they're proud of the power that they have, and they oppress people. They weigh people down with the power that they possess. Not so in the kingdom of God. There are no altars of prominence. There are no pedestals. There is no higher ground. There is no ground that is above the ground that all of us stand upon. Now, we serve in different places in the kingdom of God. We are in different places. We have different responsibilities. We don't all have the same gifts. We don't all have the same talent. We are not all given the same responsibilities by our Lord. Some of us are leaders. Some of us are followers in the kingdom of God. That's the way the Lord has ordained things in the church. There are different body parts, and these different body parts are assigned different responsibilities, different levels of responsibilities, and we follow, some of us lead, but we all do so on level ground. How is it that sometimes in the church, some of us climb up on a little altar and we start to look down on others? And we think of ourselves in really good ways. So we think of ourselves as being more responsible, more gifted, more talented than the other folks who are down there beneath us. And what happens is, it's really lonely up there in one of these lofty positions. And sometimes people fall off and they get hurt themselves, and they hurt others when they fall off their altar of prominence. And the church is wounded. There is a wounding that comes into the family of God when someone falls off one of these altars of prominence. And so it is in the world, but not in the church. The Lord led Brenda and me to the West for many years in our ministry. And we served in Long Beach, California, San Diego, California. I pastored the First Southern Baptist Church of Long Beach and the First Southern Baptist Church of San Diego for a number of years. These were really good churches with significant responsibilities. Both churches were placed right in the middle, right in the heart of a great city, a great lost city, the city of Long Beach, the city of San Diego, and all around these churches were countless lost people. The church in San Diego was right in the middle of the gay area of San Diego. You talk about a broken community. That neighborhood was broken. Right down the street from our church was a Taoist temple. Right down the street, right behind us, three blocks, was the Metropolitan Church. You know, that's the gay church. You talk about a broken people, a broken community, a broken city. And here was this church with this magnificent opportunity to reach out to these people and to touch them with the good news of Jesus Christ, to proclaim salvation in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But we were hindered in our effort. Yes, Satan was opposed to what we were striving to do. That's obvious. And the people often did not want to hear the message. And we were often limited in our resources, financial resources, sometimes limited in our leadership abilities. But you know what, if I can be honest with you, do you know what limited both the First Southern Baptist Church of Long Beach and the First Southern Baptist Church of San Diego, what limited us in our ministry more than anything else? I think you know what it was. Some people had climbed up on altars of prominence, and others had lowered themselves to places of insignificance. On one hand, this one who climbed up on an altar would become critical of others, judgmental, filled with prejudice. with feelings of ill will. And on the other hand, this one that had climbed down into a valley where he or she could not be found would forget what Christ had done for them. And they would deny their responsibility to serve, to be engaged, to be involved in the ministry of the church. And so you had these two opposing factors. Criticism in the life of some, a judgmental spirit that wounded the ministry of Christ, and a forgetfulness in the lives of others that prevented them from saying, "Yes, Lord, use me. I'm ready. Send me. Whatever it is you'd like for me to do for you in this community, I'm ready, I'm willing, I'm able to do it." I wonder about you. It is the easiest thing to forget that as you're serving the Lord, you do so on the same level as everyone else striving to serve the Lord. Nobody's better. Nobody's less. No one is more worthy. No one is less worthy. We're all on level ground. You may not be a leader. You may not have the gifts, the talents that someone else possesses, but you are someone redeemed by the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ our Lord. And I promise you, he has called you into his service, and he has blessed you with that which you need to serve him as he calls you. He does not leave you ill-prepared. He does not leave you without the tools that you need to do what he's calling you to do. He always gives strength to his people to be the folks that he has called them to be. There is, of course, more to come for us. We have met our Lord on level ground and we serve him on level ground, but there is more to come. For those of us who know him, someday we will be with him in glory. And when we are with him in glory, as the Apostle Paul speaks of here in the passage that I read, we will be seated with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. We will be seated with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. And all of those seats around our Lord in glory for all eternity are on the same level. Not a one of them is higher than the others. Not one of them is lower than the others. They're all on the same level. And that's a gift. God has given it to us out of his grace. And by his mercy, he sent his Son to make it possible. And so when we get to glory and we meet the Apostle Paul, that's going to be a good day. Right there beside the Apostle Paul, on the same level, is going to be the thief who trusted Christ at the last moment of his life and who never did anything for Christ. And the great Apostle Paul and the lowly thief who trusted Christ in an hour of desperation, well, they're both going to be on the same level before our Lord. And you ask about rewards in heaven. I don't know about rewards in heaven. You know, the Bible doesn't talk about rewards in heaven. All I know is that we have to leave all of that in the hands of our Master. Because if he loves us enough to die upon the cross for us, I think we can trust him enough for eternity and what we need throughout eternity. Do you remember the story of the landowner? And he had a vineyard, and he needed people to pick the grapes. And so early in the morning, according to Christ's story, this landowner went out into the marketplace and hired some men to come and to work in his vineyard all day long. And he said, "I'll pay you one denarius." And they said, "Wow, great." So they came, and early in the morning, they began to work. And then about 3 hours later or so, about 9 o'clock, same landowner went back to the same marketplace and saw some other people just loitering around, and he said, would you like a job for the day? And they said, yes. We said, well, come work in my vineyard. So they came and they began to work in the vineyard. And then about noon and about 3 o'clock, the landowner went back to the same marketplace and hired others. And they came and they began to work in the vineyard. And then about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, as the day was coming to an end, he went back to the marketplace, hired some more, and they came to work in the vineyard for just a short time. And then when the day ended, the landowner called his paymaster and said, bring the people together. It's time to pay them for the day. I promised them a denarius. I'll give them a denarius. Call the people I hired last first. So those who came at 5 o'clock came first, and they were each paid one denarius. And the people who were hired at 6 o'clock in the morning began to say to themselves, wow, they get one coin for 1 hour. What are we going to get for working 12 hours? And you know what happens, of course, in the Lord's parable. He pays them all exactly the same, one denarius. And the people who started work first said, wait a minute, we worked all day long in the heat of the day, and we get the same as those who worked for 1 hour? And the landowner says to them, can't I do what I want to do with my own money? And the Lord was teaching us that in His grace, He bestows His mercy as He sees fit. And according to the Word of God, He sees fit to bestow equal amounts of grace and compassion and forgiveness on all who come to Him. This is a challenge to you to evaluate your own ministry, to look at your own service, to see your own life, your life. I'm not asking you to look at His life or her life. I'm challenging you to look at your life and your service for your Lord. Have you allowed yourself to be tempted to climb up on a little hill, and you find yourself often looking down on somebody with a judgmental, prejudicial, critical spirit? Or have you allowed yourself to disappear in the body of Christ and to become one who is not serving the Lord because you don't have confidence in yourself, or because you're tired, or because you just don't want to? I challenge you to see one more thing. There is this marvelous scene in the Gospel of John where our Lord is becoming quite famous. He has just stood before the tomb of Lazarus and said, come forth. And Lazarus has come forth from the tomb, and the crowds are amazed. He has just marched into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey, triumphantly marching into Jerusalem, and the crowds gathered along the road, and they threw palm branches down before him and had cried out to him, Hosanna, he who comes in the name of the Lord. Such acclaim, such glory was being bestowed upon the Lord. And the gospel writer John says that Christ was aware that the Father had put all things under his feet. What that means is that Christ knew fully that the Father had bestowed upon him all the power in all creation. He had placed this power at his use. Beneath his feet, what Christ could do knew no limit. Creator God, present in the person of Jesus Christ. But John says, the gospel writer says, that with his awareness of all of this power, that at dinner time, Christ removed his robe and wrapped a towel around his waist and knelt before each of his disciples one at a time and washed their feet with a basin of water and a simple towel. He washed their feet. Now, this is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the creator of all that is, the Son of God. And he kneels before these unworthy, dirty disciples and washes their feet. That's what we need in the church. We need towels. We need to remember that we're all saved in the same way, that we all serve on the same level, and we're all looking forward to the same thing. But right now, what we need are towels. Our hymn of invitation is 220. I invite you to come here to this altar and to tell the Lord what it is that he's asking you to do. Say yes to him. You don't need to talk to me. You can just kneel here privately. Get things right with the Lord in your own life. If you're not a member of this church and you feel the Lord leading you to this church, come. One of the deacons will be here to greet you and to help you in that process. Whatever it is that the Lord is inviting you to do today, do it. Do it today. Let's stand together and let's sing.